हेलो गाइस, वेलकम एवरीवन टू माय चैनल। एंड टुडे वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक, दैट इज अ हाइपोनेट्रेमिया। सो इन द फ्लूइड एंड इलेक्ट्रोलाइट बैलेंस, द मेजर टॉपिक, द सॉफ्ट टॉपिक दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे इज हाइपोनेट्रेमिया। सो बिफोर टॉकिंग अबाउट द हाइपोनेट्रेमिया, लेट अस नो दैट द नॉर्मल सीरम लेवल ऑफ द सोडियम इज 135 टू 145 मिली इक्विवेलेंट पर लीटर। So what is hyponatremia? If the serum level falls below 135 milli equivalent per liter or milli mole per liter, then in that condition we will call this condition as a hyponatremia. So what is hyponatremia? So decrease in serum level more than 135 milli equivalent per liter is known as hyponatremia. Hello guys. So while talking about the classification of hyponatremia, hyponatremia are basically the three types: hypovolemic hyponatremia, euvolemic hyponatremia, and hypervolemic hyponatremia. And we will discuss each type in a great detail. So in the hypovolemic hyponatremia, as the name suggests, as the name is telling hypovolemia, it means there is a decrease in the total body fluid. So there is a decrease in the total body fluid. And also, as the name says, hyponatremia, so there is a decrease in the sodium levels also. So there is a decrease in the body fluid levels and there is a decrease in the sodium levels. So what are the conditions where there is a decrease in the body fluid level and there is a decrease in the sodium levels also? So let's talk about those conditions. So the causes are basically, first we will talk about the GI losses. So GI losses means this is the gastrointestinal losses. So basically, when a person does the vomit or when the person does diarrhea, so if there is a vomiting or diarrhea, you know that there is a excretion of the water along with salt. So if there is a vomiting, either vomiting or diarrhea, there will be the excretion of the water along with the salt, and that's why there will be the decrease in the body fluid level and there is decrease in the salt level, that is level of sodium also. The second cause is the renal cause. So renal cause means simply, if let's suppose you are using a diuretics, and let's suppose you are using the loop diuretics or you are using the thiazide diuretics. So in the loop diuretics, in the thiazide diuretics, basically these diuretics, what they will do, the diuretics means simply they inhibit absorption of salt and water via kidney, or we can say via nephrons. So the diuretics inhibit the absorption of salt and water via the nephrons, and due to which there will be the loss of water as well as salt in the urine, and that's why there will be decrease in the body fluid and there is a decrease in the sodium level also. The third cause can be the subarachnoid hemorrhage, that is subarachnoid hemorrhage. So in the subarachnoid hemorrhage, there is actually the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So in the patients of subarachnoid hemorrhage, there will be actually release of BNP, that is brain natriuretic peptide, and if there will be the release of the BNP, this release of the BNP, that is brain natriuretic peptide, will cause natriuresis. So natriuresis means there will be the excretion of the sodium as well as water via urine, via the kidney in the form of urine. So there will be excretion of the more salt as well as more water, and that's why when a person is having the subarachnoid hemorrhage, that there can be the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So I have just said you one condition, that in the subarachnoid hemorrhage there will be release of the BNP, but there are many conditions related to brain in which there will be release of the BNP, that is brain natriuretic peptide. And if there is a release of BNP, there will be the excretion of sodium as well as water. And if there is a excretion of sodium and water, there will be hypovolemic hyponatremia. So this condition is known as cerebral salt wasting syndrome. This condition is known as cerebral salt wasting syndrome. So this is a MCQ question, that what is cerebral salt wasting syndrome. So it is a condition related to the brain in which there is a release of BNP, and whenever there is a release of BNP, there will be excretion of the salt as well as water in the urine, and there can be the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So in the entrance you can be asked that hypovolemic hyponatremia is related to the cerebral salt wasting syndrome. So this is a MCQ question. The fourth causes is Addison's disease. So in Addison's disease, what will be happen? There will be actually hypoaldosteronism. It simply means that there will be the decreased level of aldosterone in the blood. So there will be, in hypoaldosteronism means there is a decreased level of aldosterone in blood. And if there will be decreased level of aldosterone in the blood, then there will be, as we know that the aldosterone basically cause the salt and water retention. Aldosterone cause salt and water retention from kidney. So from kidney, the aldosterone causes salt and water retention. But if there is a decreased level of aldosterone in the blood, there will be decreased retention of salt and water. And if there is a decreased retention of salt and water, it means more salt and water are excreting via the kidney. So more salt and water are excreted in urine, and there can be the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So in different causes of the aldosterone, in any causes, if there will be hypoaldosteronism, it means there is a decreased level of aldosterone in the blood, then there can be the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So broadly we can say in the hypovolemic hyponatremia, there are two causes. One cause is renal cause, and other all cause we can put in the extra renal causes, like the GI causes are extra renal causes, but like the use of the diuretics or cerebral salt wasting syndrome or Addison disease. So these are the renal causes. So simply by the history you can differentiate the extra renal causes and renal causes. That person will tell you that I was having the diarrhea or vomiting, then you will ultimately know that this is the GI causes. But yes, you have to confirm it by the lab test also. So how will you confirm by the lab test that this is the hyponatremia is due to the renal causes or the extra renal causes? So simply you should know one thing, that in the GI causes, what happened in the GI causes, that there will be salt and water are losing via mouth, or in the vomiting salt and water are losing, getting excreted by mouth, and in the diarrhea via the GI tract. So in this way the salt and water are losing, and in the response to that kidney, or you can say the nephrons, tries to preserve water, as already there is a wasting of the salt and water via the GI tract. So the kidney tries to preserve water, and due to which salt and water, absorption via kidney is increased. So the absorption of salt and water via the kidney is increased if the causes GI causes. And in these patients, if you will check the level of sodium in the urine, then you will find that the level of sodium in the urine is decreased. Why? Already in the kidney, the sodium has been absorbed in a higher quantity, as the kidney tries to preserve whatever the, tries to compensate whatever the loss has been gone through via the GI tract. So that is why there will be decreased amount of sodium in the urine, and there is a decreased amount of urine also. So the amount of urine also decreased. So the amount of urine is also decreased in case of the extra renal causes. But in the renal causes, what happens that the salt and water are excreted via the GI, via the kidney. So there will be more level of or increased level of sodium in the urine in the renal causes. So in the renal causes, there will be more amount of sodium in the urine, and the urine will be almost higher in amount. So the amount urine amount is also increased. So see, you can clearly see the difference in the lab test, that in the renal causes there will be increased sodium in the urine as the sodium and water are getting excreted in the urine. But in the extra renal causes, the level of sodium is decreased in the urine as the kidney tries to preserve the loss that has been running in the GI tract. Now there is a word known as pseudohyponatremia. So what is pseudohyponatremia? So basically, the name says pseudo means false. Pseudo means false, and hyponatremia, it means that in actual, there is a no hyponatremia. So in the persons of pseudohyponatremia, in actually there will be no hyponatremia. But in the lab, if you will check this level of sodium, you will find decreased sodium levels. So why is it so? So in some persons, if he or she is having the hyperlipidemia, so if there is a higher amount of lipid in the blood, in that cases, what will happen? That the higher amount of the lipid may interfere the sodium levels in blood. So higher amount of the lipid may interfere with the sodium levels in the blood, but just in the lab report there will be decreased sodium, but there is no decreased level of sodium in the blood. Just the hyperlipidemia interferes the level of sodium in the blood while investigating in the lab, not there is actually decrease in the level of sodium. That is why this condition is known as pseudohyponatremia. So this is an entrance MCQ question, that pseudohyponatremia is related to the hyperlipidemia. So hyperlipidemia is related to the pseudohyponatremia. Now there is another term, hypertonic hyponatremia. So these are the extra thing you have to know. The three classification that you already studied, that hypovolemic hyponatremia, or euvolemic hyponatremia, or the hypervolemic I will discuss that also. We have only discussed hypovolemic hyponatremia. So they were actually under the hypotonic hyponatremia. So this is a different entry, that is hypertonic hyponatremia. It means simply means that there will be increased osmolarity in the blood, and due to this increased osmolarity there will be the hyponatremia. So hypertonic means increased osmolarity in blood, and that will ultimately cause hyponatremia. So let's see how it causes the hyponatremia. So let us suppose this is a blood vessel, and let's suppose this is a cell. This is a cell, and this is a blood vessel. Now let us suppose that your blood sugar is increased. Let's suppose any patient is having the high levels of blood sugar. So if there is increased level of blood sugar, then simply you can see that the osmolarity of the osmolarity of the blood vessel is increased. So there is a high amount of the blood sugar in the blood vessel, so there will be increased osmolarity. So if there is increased osmolarity, there will be the solvent drag. Solvent drag means that the blood vessel will drag the solvent from the peripheral things. It means the solvent will get dragged from, I mean the water will get simply come to the blood vessels via the from the interstitium, from the cells. So this is known as solvent drag. So ultimately in the blood vessel, the amount of the water will increase. So if there is an increased amount of water, but the level of sodium is not increased, it is normal. So due to the increased amount of water in the in the blood vessel, there will be relatively dilutional hyponatremia. That due to the increased amount of the water in the blood vessel, there will be the relatively deficiency of the sodium levels in the blood. So this in this way you can see that if there is an increased osmolarity due to the solvent drag, water will come into the blood vessels, and due to the entry of the water into the blood vessels, there will be decreased level of sodium. So this is known as dilutional hyponatremia. So in this way you can see that the hypertonicity can lead to the hyponatremia. Example is diabetes mellitus. Okay, and middle we talked about the pseudo hyponatremia, and we also talked about the hypertonic hyponatremia. So those were a little different entity. Now let's again come to the hypovolemic hyponatremia. So in the hypovolemic hyponatremia, the main thing is that there is decreased amount of the total body fluid, and there is decreased amount of total body salt also. So that's why there is a decreased amount of total body sodium also. So simply the sodium levels is decreased. Now in this condition, what are the clinical feature that the patient will suffer? So the patient will suffer simply the signs and symptoms of, let's suppose the patient will be having the nausea, vomiting, and so there will be the history of the either the nausea, the vomiting, or there can be history of the use of any diuretics, or there can be the history of the subarachnoid hemorrhage or any brain problems. So there can be anything, the problem can be many things. So now due to the hyponatremia, what will be the clinical sign and symptom that the patient will come to you? So the sign and symptom will be like the, if there is a decreased level of sodium, there will be headache, there will be confusion, and there will be lethargy, and as the body fluid is decreased, so there will be the signs of dehydration. And you can tell me what are the signs of dehydration. The signs of dehydration are basically the dry mouth and decreased sweat and increased capillary refill time. There will be the sunken eye. So these are the signs of the dehydration. So there can be the signs of dehydration in the person, and there can be confusion, headache, lethargy. So some of you may ask me that why in the hypovolemic hyponatremia there will be the headache, confusion, lethargy. Yes, sign of dehydration is very obvious, that if the person is losing the body fluid, then this it is obvious that there can be the signs of dehydration. But why there will be the signs of the like the headache, confusion, lethargy, and sometimes the person may have the seizures also. So why these features are present? So let me make you explain that. Let's suppose that this is a blood vessel, and let's suppose this is neuron cell. You can take any cell. I am taking the neuron cell. This is a neuron cell. Okay, this is a blood vessel. So let's suppose now this is sodium is decreased in the blood vessels, and if the sodium is decreased, so there is a low osmolarity present over here. So there is a low osmolarity, and in the cell there will be relatively high osmolarity. So simply you can say that if there is a high osmolarity in the cells and low osmolarity in the blood vessels, the fluid will be moved from the low osmolarity to the high osmolarity. The fluid movement will be from the low osmolarity to the high osmolarity. This is a simply concept of the osmosis, that always the fluid will move from the low osmolarity to the high osmolarity. So the fluid from the blood vessels will get travel into the neuronal cells, and now the neuronal cells will actually swell up. So there will be the swelling of neurons. So you can say that there is simply the intraneuronal edema, and you can say that there can be the brain edema. So in the overall, if you see the brain, so there can be the brain edema. So that's why if there is a brain edema, that is why the person was having the headache, the person was having the confusion, the person was having the seizure, the lethargy. So these were the features basically due to the reason that there was the brain edema. Now let's talk about another topic, that is euvolemic hyponatremia. You will talk about the management later, and let's talk first about the all types first. So let's talk about euvolemic hyponatremia. See, euvolemic hyponatremia, basically this is known as the dilutional hyponatremia. So it simply means that there is actually decreased in the sodium level, but that is not due to the exact sodium level loss. That is basically due to the increased amount of the total body fluid. So if there is an increased amount of total body fluid and there will be the normal level of sodium, so in overall we can say there will be the hyponatremia. So due to the increased volume of the fluid, increased total body fluid, there will be the hyponatremia, but in actually there is no loss of the sodium in these cases. So though you may tell me that here is the increased level of total, there is increased level of total body fluid, but I am telling this is the euvolemic hyponatremia. So some of you might be thinking that he is telling wrong, but no, I am telling right. Euvolemic is actually a misnomer. Simply euvolemic doesn't mean that it is a normal volume. Many students think that euvolemic means the normal volume, but yes, I will tell you that euvolemic is a misnomer. It doesn't mean the normal volume. But though it is called euvolemic, as there will be the hyponatremia, but the clinical sign and symptoms will be either very mild or absent. So apparently the patient will not have the any features of the hyponatremia in the euvolemic hyponatremia cases, but yes, if you check the lab blood levels, you will get the hyponatremia. But apparently euvolemic hyponatremia may be a incidental finding. You will not find the euvolemic hyponatremia. I said you that the euvolemic simply means in clinically the patient will be, apparently the patient will be very all right, or the clinically there will be no sign and symptom, or very mild symptoms can be present there. Euvolemic does not mean that there is a normal volume or normal level of body fluid. It simply means that there will be a very mild symptom, or there will be no symptom at all. But yes, in this condition there will be increased amount of total body fluid, but there's a normal sodium levels. But if there is increased amount of total body fluid, and though if the person has having normal sodium level, in the lab you will get the decreased amount of sodium. So what are the causes? So first cause we can say that in the pregnancy. So in the pregnancy, you know that due to the hormones, there will be increased amount of total body fluid, and there will be the euvolemic hyponatremia, but that will not show any clinical features. Another example is SIADH, or we can say that this is a syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. So ADH is secreted inappropriately, or you can say there is increased amount of ADH secretion. there is increased amount of ADH secretion. And if there is increased amount of ADH secretion, either due to the ectopic ADH secreting in a tumor, for example, the ADH secreting, ectopic ADH secreting tumor are basically the small cell cancer of lung, and either due to the any brain infection, like for example, parasitic infection like the toxoplasma infection. So either due to any brain infection like the toxoplasmosis, or due to any ectopic ADH secreting tumor like the small cell cancer of the lung, if there's increased amount of ADH in the blood, so simply there can be the we can say that the ADH will cause the absorption of water via collecting tubules. So the ADH will cause the water retention. See, I am telling you what, only the water retention, not the salt retention. It ADH will cause the retention of water via collecting duct, or you can say collecting tubules in the nephron, and via the V2 receptor. So there is a V2 receptor present in the collecting duct cells, and this V2 receptor present over the collecting duct cells will cause the retention of the water, and due to the retention of the water, there can be the increased total body fluid, and if there is increased total body fluid, there will be the hyponatremia. So this was the two causes. The third cause is post operative patient, that after the any operation, if the patient is continuously given the IV fluids, especially the isotonic fluid is given continuously, then there can be the increased amount of the total body fluid, but there can be the normal level of salt, and there can be the hyponatremia. The fourth example is hypothyroidism. Yes, the exact cause why the hypothyroidism causes the volumic hyponatremia is unknown, but it is said that it is related to the ADH. So if there is a hypothyroidism, there is an increased level of ADH, and that is ultimately cause the hyponatremia. The fourth is called the beer potomania. So any person is having the mania to take the beer, so large amount of the beer can ultimately lead to the increase the total body fluid, and ultimately the person will be having the volumic hyponatremia. Another thing, there is the psychogenic polydipsia. So if a person is having the continuous thrust again for the water, so he is taking a large amount of water. Let's suppose he is taking the 10 liters or 12 liters in a day, so a large amount of water intake. So due to the large amount of water intake, there can be the polydipsia. So this is known as psychogenic polydipsia, as the person is taking through his or her own will. The seventh cause is endurance marathon runner. See what happened in the marathon races. Basically, the weight limit is present there. It means that a marathon runner will have a certain weight. Let's suppose some running will be in the lightweight category, some running will be in the moderate weight category, and some running will be in the high weight category. So there will be the categories of the marathon running. So if any marathon player is having the let's suppose he should be fit under the weight 60. So there is actually the interval. So let's suppose the person should be of the 50 to 70 kg weight. And let us suppose the marathon runner, before 2 or 3 days of running, he has to pass the lightweight criteria, and he has to pass this lightweight criteria at the day of running also. So let's suppose he is having the weight 72 kg. So he has to lose at least 2 kg in 1 or 2 days. So how will he lose the 1 or 2 days? So what he will do? He will actually decrease the intake of water, intake of the salt. So due to the decreased intake of the water and salt, after 2 days when he actually present in the marathon competition, he will actually pass the lightweight criteria. So he will fall in the category of 50 to 60 kg and he will lose 2 kg of the weight. But what happens, say that this person, when he starts running, he thinks that I should take water as my body is dehydrated, and now he takes the water. And when he takes water, there will be if he takes the large amount of water, the water loss he is having will be replenished. But the salt loss is not replenished in 1 day, that has been lost in 2 or 3 days. So that is why there will be relatively the hyponatremia. So that is why the endurance marathon runner will be having the hyponatremia. The endurance marathon runner, when he starts running, in that day they will ultimately collapse via the hyponatremia in the competition and they may lose the game. So that is not the good way to actually lose the weight. Okay, that is a different entity. Now let's talk about the treatment. So the treatment is simply this is simply the increased amount of the total body fluid. So simply you should restrict the fluid intake.